Physics, logic, mathematics. So he's a very broad philosopher. And remember, we said he's pointing down, and Plato's pointing up in the picture of the school of Athens. And what were they obviously talking about?
The theories of form.
Yeah, where do forms reside? Plato's pointing up that they're transcendent. Remember, sendare, the movement of potency to its actuality. Or the actualization of some potency. Now, motion is a species of change. Particular type of change, namely change in place. So let me give you the next slide. And show you how this would work. Remember when we talked about Zeno, who believed, and Parmenides, because they were the same school, the Eleatics. They believed all was one. And if all was one, you can't have change in motion, because if I'm walking from point A to B, and point A and B are the same place, then I haven't gone anywhere. So it's important to be able to make this distinction. When I'm at point A, I'm not at point B, correct? Add another distinction. Well, I'm potentially capable of being at point B. Now, actuality and potency are in every material thing. Why? Because actuality is form and potency is the matter. So my material being is potentially at point B, but not actually there yet. So they stand in an inverse relationship. My potency is as high as it can get. And that's why, going back to that slide, that you have a pure potency. It's as high as it can get because I could potentially be anywhere. I could walk over there, I could lay down, I could jump around. There's a lot of different things that I can do. So before I start acting or doing something, my potency is at the highest level, and actually being or doing something beyond stance at A is at its lowest until I begin to change and act towards something. Watch. So when I take this step, now I am decreasing my potential to be or do or say other things because I'm moving towards a goal, an actual goal. And so the actuality, and I can stop and I can change. But watch what happens as I continue. Am I at point B? No. I'm getting closer. So my potency, my potential to be at other places is going down, while my actuality, now my potency to be at point B is at as low as possible. And my actuality, I'm actually at point B. Now, do you see how that definition makes sense? What is change? The actualization of some particular potency. Now that's motion, but think about if you have some clay, you can say the same thing. I can change that into make a sculpture. But potentially, well, let me put it this way. It's not anything actual yet. So its potency is just a clump is very high until you start to do what? Put a form or an idea into the clay. And then you will get that change. Potency, actualization of that potency. So that is a great definition, Aristotelian definition for change. The movement of potency towards its actuality and the actualization of some potency. Now, because matter is always in a state of potency, it never gets to a point where, actually perfect. That's hearkening back to Plato. You can never find anything perfect in the material world. You'll never find a perfect triangle. It'll always be never a perfect tree. So you never, just because you actualize some potency, now you have new potencies. You can sit down, you can walk somewhere else, you can lay down. So you never lose your potency as long as you're tied to some or referring to some material. You just have to qualify once that potency is actualized, there's new potencies that you can think about and talk about. Plato was a dualist because Plato believed there were two realms, an illusory, material, empirical, sensible realm that's constantly changing, which is separated, it's unreal, from the true world of forms. And so according to Plato, substance, which we can translate in Greek, it's ousia. Ousia means the being of something, the existence of something. Plato thought, well, you can translate it actually like this. Substance, just in its colloquial use, simple usage, thing, or real thing. So when somebody says, grab the substance, refer to the substance, their meaning, simply translated, grab that thing there. Refer to the thing there. Obviously, or the real thing, according to your philosophical paradigm, what you consider to be real things is going to differ. If you're a Platonist, you're going to say these are not real things and therefore they're not substances. Why? Because real things, or real, i.e. substances, for Plato, are transcendent immaterial forms. For Aristotle, he's going to say, no, the real things are the empirical things. Yes, form makes them real, but forms don't exist outside, they exist inside them. You put your ideas into. So there is this famous quote, which is complicated, but I'll translate it for you to make it a bit more easy, from Aristotle's Organon, which was his logical works, where he defines what a substance is in the truest sense of the word. Because we can speak about substance maybe in a derivative sense or in a loose sense, but he's going to first define what do we mean in the very most primary and truest sense of the word. What he's saying is any particular thing that you can refer to. So remember those terms, particular versus universal. What was the difference? Is this a universal or a particular? This is a universal? So universal means all. So you can refer to. And particular is singular. So red pen or red penness is a universal because it would include all the members of the class of red pens. Or red is a universal because it It refers to all members of things that are red. But this red pen is it universal or particular? Particular. What Aristotle is saying, that is the very primary and most definite sense in which we use the word substance. This is most real. So what he actually does, he inverts Plato's argument. Remember Plato said, well, that tree at one point wasn't a tree, and now it's becoming and it's changing, then it will go out of existence. But the idea of tree, the form, never changes. Aristotle counters that argument by saying, how could you have the idea of tree if there wasn't that particular oak tree, if there wasn't the spruce, if there wasn't, that doesn't make any sense. Do you see? He's flipped it and saying, no, how can you have people, the form, if there are no people? That doesn't make any sense. So it's the empirical things that make the form or make a substance in the truest sense. Well, you can anticipate somebody asking, well, can't we refer to abstract ideas or universals as substance? And he would say yes, in a secondary or derivative sense, we can. So this animal right here, this particular dog, Fido, would be a substance in the primary sense. Dog is a general or universal concept, would be, according to Aristotle, a substance in the secondary sense. Does that make some sense? Let me put it this way. Anything that you could bring in, a particular thing that you could bring into this room and show me, is a substance in the primary, most definite sense of the word. You can't bring in concepts and tangibly show them to me. But number two, so therefore, it's a substance in a derivative or secondary sense. How about, give me another example. Somebody throw out an example and then you guys try to figure out, is it primary or secondary substance according to Aristotle? Vegetable. Primary or secondary substance? Good job. That's right, because you cannot bring in vegetable and we can't eat it. It's a concept. It includes all vegetables. But what about broccoli? Primary or secondary? Secondary. You can't bring in broccoli yet. You can bring in a particular piece of broccoli. But you can't bring in broccoli. Here, eat broccoli because it includes all broccoli. So that's impossible. It's a concept. What's that?
Heat.
Heat. That's another. That's a concept. But you can give me a hot object or heat within an object. Good one.
So, like back to broccoli, so you have to like specify it and say like, oh, eat this piece of broccoli.
Yeah, I like to use, exactly, that's why I like to use the word this. You can put that in the, that'll be on the quiz, to distinguish the difference between primary and secondary substance. You can just, this, so this is a pronoun referring or pointing out ostensibly some entity or object or substance. So this man, this dog, this piece of broccoli, it makes it very clear that that's different than the concept of dog, man, or broccoli. Good one, guys. So here's just a nice slide explaining the differences between Plato's understanding of substances, i.e. real things, versus Aristotle. Or if you want extra credit, you can call him Eric-stotle. For Plato, substances or real things are pure forms which do not exist in this material world, but only exist independent of matter, either in the mind. Remember, they've existed within you forever, eternally. You've just forgotten them and need to recollect them. Or as eternal objects apart from matter in Platonic heavens or the mind of God, however you want to think about that. But for Aristotle, substances, in a true sense, the word real things, are empirical physical things. And what makes them real? Not their matter, the form in the matter. So, Aristotle is not a dualist. He does not believe in two realms. He believes in one realm and uses two concepts to make a distinction of saying what is make something be what it is and what is it made out of. His theory of substance is called hylomorphism. So not dualism, not substance dualism, as we'll see. It's Descartes says there's two worlds, both real, a world of immaterial things and a world of material things. So two substances, real things. That is, if you ascribe to that, you're a substance dualist. Aristotle is not a substance dualist. He is a substance monist. How many different types of things, real things in the world? One. Understood in two different ways. This hylo comes from the Greek word hyle. And morphe. So let's start with the more familiar one, morphe. If you morph into something, you change what? If I take a circle and I morph it into another shape, I've changed its what?
Form.
Got it. So morphe in Greek means form. Hylomorphism. From hylo, we get highly from hylo. And highly means, and we're going to guess, we already got form. What were the two concepts that are good? Concepts that, so we got form. What's the other one? Matter. Highly means matter. So what Aristotle would say is, substance is one. It's not composed of multiple things, but you can understand it in two different ways. You can talk about one thing in two different ways. You can talk about its form, and you can talk about its matter. Matter is, so if you look at this desk, you can talk about what is it made out of. Well, then you're referring to its matter. And form is, well, what is the matter made into? To illustrate the point of Aristotle being the common sense philosopher, let's take an example. Suppose there's nothing on this board that is not. And then we bring in a six-year-old. And we ask the six-year-old, how many things are on the board? Now, we can't tell the six-year-old how many substances, because they don't, that's too difficult for them to understand. What do you think the six-year-old would say? How many things are on the board there? One. Wouldn't it be strange if they said two? And you say, what? Well, redness and circleness. You would know immediately, your parents are Platonist. Because six-year-olds don't come up with that kind of stuff. They've been training you in Platonic thought. Plato would say, you have two things there. You have the form of red and you have the form of circle. But common sense is going to say, no, there's only one thing, two different ways of talking about that. Think about it this way. I have a bunch of matter, ink, and it's potentially potency is really high because it's chaotic and I haven't really formed it or shaped it into anything. But watch, now I have an idea of circle. And what am I going to do? I am going to put the form in the matter. I'm going to form the matter until it reaches my, pretty close to my idea of what circle is. So now do I have one or two things? No, I have, according to Aristotle, one thing. Two different ways of understanding it. The matter, which would be what it's made out of, red ink. But the red ink could be made into any, formed into anything. It was just potentially really anything until you did what? Until you started bringing the matter into conformity. Notice what that word. What do you notice in that? Form. On, with. To form. The matter is forming with the idea of circle. So again, you have the illustration of really two sides of one coin. Not two coins, two different ways of looking or understanding the empirical world, what it's made out of, and what the matter is made into. That is hylomorphism. I only believe one thing there, one substance, but two different ways to talk about that and understand that. Questions on that so far? So how is Aristotle using form and why? He's trying to use that to answer, what is this? What is this thing here? What is that substance? And what makes it something? The Greek word apodoti, rather than a mere heap. How many people have Legos or played with Legos when they were? Yeah, I love Legos. If I take my Lego box and I pour it out and I say, look at my beautiful creation, and you're going to say, what? It's a big heap of metal. Like, you haven't made your Legos into anything. That's a heap. Then if I took some of those Lego parts, those material parts, and I constructed a Lego castle, a Lego Death Star, then I ask you, what's the difference between this heap and what I just made? What would you say? The form. You took all the parts and you arranged them and gave them a sort of unity. They're all coming together and working together now, because you construct it that way, into a single idea or a single substance, the Lego Death Star. That's what form does, is it answers what makes that thing a thing, something, rather than a mere just collection of parts. Now, that's what we would call an artifact, because there's nothing naturally binding that unity. But for living things, and this is Aristotle's biology, form is a unifying principle. Now, what is nice about Aristotle is it offers a response and critique of what we know is reductionism. Has anybody ever heard of that? It comes up a lot in modern science and scientific debates. You might have heard the expression, you're nothing more than a bunch of atoms in motion. Love is nothing more than a chemical, i.e. dopamine. How many people have heard that? That's to reduce what you would say is higher level phenomenon. That, well, it looks like you're living here. Well, no, you just reduce it to the simplest parts. That would be like saying, that Death Star is really not anything other than the tiny little Lego pieces. That is to reduce that higher level phenomenon to the most simplest parts. Aristotle counters that. It says, no, you are not simply a bunch of atoms in motion. You might, that might be your material parts, but you cannot be reduced to it. You're much more than that. Now, in order to make that argument and refute reductionism, you would have to show that the whole is actually greater than the parts. Because reductionism basically says, whatever you perceive the whole is, can simply be reduced to parts. So they're equal. To refute this, you'd have to say the contradiction of that, the opposite. You could argue that the whole is in fact greater than the parts. That when you get a whole together, you have something more than just the individual parts, then you've refuted that. Okay, so what do I mean by whole? Let's say the number 3. I can analyze that into the parts. The whole is simply equal to the parts. That would be an illustration of reduction. There is nothing number 3 has that the sum of 1 plus 1 plus 1 has. Therefore, if you could show 3 is more than that, then you could refute that. Aristotle does this by saying, Bob is a whole, and it's composed of what letters, parts? Is the whole greater than the parts? Can you find something in the whole that the parts don't have? Think hard. And in the unity, can you find something that's not in being A? Something, so union, to bring together. When you bring these parts together, do you get something here that you can't find in being A? Well, no, just you. Who said that? Bob. You cannot find Bob in being A. You can only find that when they come together. Therefore, we have one illustration, and this is straight out of Aristotle. In fact, the whole is greater than the parts. But let's make a distinction. Aristotle would say the parts are the matter, and the whole is the form. Now, Aristotle's famous for saying, in a way, yes, in a way, no. If I asked you, are you here in the room right now? And you answered, in a way, yes, in a way, no. We would obviously want to ask, well, in what way, yes, and what way, no. Do you see that by making that statement, it forces one into making a distinction, and making a distinction forces one towards knowledge? Which is one towards knowledge. So if I asked you, well, obviously you're here because what? You're physically here. Right, that would be, and now I've got some further information. So if Aristotle says, is asked the question, are the parts equal to the whole? In a way, yes, in a way, no. Materially, the parts and whole are equal. You don't find the letter C or any other letter in that. But in a way, no, because once the parts come together, you get something new. You get the sound Bob. Let's do a modern example. Water is composed of what parts? hydrogens and one oxygen. Is the whole greater than the part? The Aristotelian in answer. Is that what Aristotle answers? Yes. Are you dead? Yes. He's going to make what? He's going to say, in a way.
Yes, I'm in a way.
In what way, yes, are the parts equal to the whole, or the whole equal to the parts? Yeah. You're not finding a nitrogen in it. Yes. You have, do you remember in chemistry, balancing your equations? You have exactly two hydrogens on the right-hand side and one oxygen. So there's no more parts on the left side that is not on the right side. Yes, the parts, the whole is equal to the parts. In what way, no?
It's not combined, so it's just two hydrogen and one oxygen.
And what happens when you combine them? Yes. These are gases. This has the property as a liquid or solid depending on the temperature, or a gas depending on the temperature. But let's say it's in its liquid state. It has the property of liquidity. Can you find liquid, the property of liquid, in anywhere in hydrogen or oxygen? You get something new when it's, you get a substantial change. So even chemistry uses Aristotelian vocabulary. What is the difference in chemistry between a mixture and a chemical compound? If I put...
Is it like material where the individual parts don't mix together?
There is no substantial chemical change. You're just putting, it's like putting rocks and sand together. That's a mixture. Or sugar and water. It doesn't make a new chemical. It's mixed up to, maybe you can't see it, but you don't get a new sort of thing. But if I put, let's see. Say I put electrodes and I put a negative and positive charge into water. So I put something in a charge, I get something new. I get a separation and new substances emerge out of it. Okay, so again, for living things though, so if we go beyond water, there's even more unity. So Aristotle would answer, are you simply the sum of your material parts? Are you just atoms? Well, think about if we wanted to be consistent, how ridiculous that would be. If I'm simply atoms, then I'm no different than this. And if I'm no different than this, I can't go to jail. Right? How are you going to sentence a table? Does that even make sense legally? But if you can't make a distinction between ourselves as living human beings and inanimate objects, material objects like this, how are you going to apply these moral or legal concepts to be binding upon us? You have to have some sort of distinction. People don't think these things out, that if I'm just matter in motion, then what's wrong with murdering somebody, cutting somebody up into little pieces and eating them for breakfast? It's no different. If you were going to be consistent with your materialism, that's no different than the rock rolling down the hill. But everybody knows that's absurd. Clearly, there's something wrong with that are cutting up people and eating them for breakfast. Why? Because you're more than just atoms being pushed around. You can use Aristotle to make an argument like that. So, what makes something be more than what the material parts are? The form. And you can think about form, what something essentially is. The nature or essence of something. The Greek word for form we already discussed is eidos, which sounds like idea, which is exactly what it is. And for Aristotle, that's going to include the essence and the classes or parts that make that up. Let me go back to this. He makes a distinction between substantial forms and accidental forms. That doesn't mean like, car accident. But just in the sense of the opposite of being essential would be accidental. In other words, what essential is, you can't take away essential things without them being destroyed. Are wheels and tires essential for a car? Or if better yet, is a motor engine essential for it? Yes, because if you take that away, it's no longer a car. It can't. Right? Yeah. I mean, you can think through something like red pen. Is red essential? Yeah, you can't take it away without it being. What about three-sidedness of a triangle? Can you take away that property and still have a triangle? Can you have a two-sided triangle? No, you can't. So you know that's something essential. Accidental would be all the things that you can take away, and it's still essentially what it is. Could I take away redness from a triangle and still have a triangle? Yeah. So redness is a form, but it's an accidental form. So now we can think about ourselves. You have a lot of different properties that make you different from everybody else. Your skin color, your hair color, your eye color, your age, all the different things, the clothes that you wear. Now, we have something that makes us all the same. What we are by our nature or essence. And that is, we are all equally human beings. So if I change my hair color, would I cease being a human being? So is that an essential form or an accidental form, according to Aristotle?
Accidental.
Change my eye color, I can even take my eyes out, and I'd still be a human being. So those are accidental properties or accidental forms. Okay. So when you name something, what is this? You might refer to the parts that are included in the definition, a wood desk. But what makes the wood a desk and not a bed or a tree? The form. That is the essence. And that's why we can say for Aristotle, form and essence are the same. Now, what you don't get in Aristotle, apart from his concept of God, you will never find form without some particular matter that's forming. You will never find matter that's not in some particular configuration or form. I should qualify that when we did the red circle, that's a very superficial notion of form, is shape. And for that, it'll work. But when we get higher up and into things like chemicals, into living things, when we say you are form, we're going much deeper than your shape. Because look, I just changed my shape. I didn't change my essence or my form. So it goes deeper and means something much more profound the higher that you go up in the chain of beings. Any questions so far or thoughts you'd like to add?
So if forms are eternal and they're dependent on matter, does that mean matter is just as eternal?
Oh, that's a great question. Actually, Aristotle believes matter. So in Plato believes that he believes in God is the form of good, but God doesn't create in Plato's theory. He has what's called a demiurge. Do you know what a demiurge is? But a demiurge is like a demigod. It's not the highest reality and being, but it's higher than us. He had this concept of a demiurge is what created the material world. So not God, but a demiurge is kind of a demigod. Aristotle rejected, so in Plato's theory, the physical material world was created, and it was created, the demiurge was looking up at the forms, like, oh, I'll make this, I'll make that, and create the material world. Aristotle believes that the world, the material universe, is eternal. There was never any beginning to. So that, absolutely, you would say, yes, matter and forms are eternal. The world has always been moving, and there was, and so Aristotle's God is not a creator God either. There is no creator. It's forms that create matter, and they've been just doing that forever. In fact, the idea that the universe, the cosmos, had a beginning in time, that it wasn't eternal, is a very recent idea that comes up with the theory of the Big Bang, which is probably not much older than 100 years old. So even through modern science, most people believe the universe, the physical universe, was eternal until we accepted the theory of the Big Bang. Ben. Other questions? Well, that was a great one. You nailed it. But Aristotle's universe, material universe, is eternal. And so, that's right. Matter and forms have always been.
If the universe is always eternal, always expanding,
never ending,
and
it's just going to be a great way. Physicists talk about something called
the Big Crunch. Yeah,
you went too far for the universe.
I was done. We'll end up in
part is over.
I was done. We'll end up like drifting away from where we're at in our galaxy and going up to our body.
There's different theories. There's the oscillating theory that eventually that it crunches. There's the cold universe that basically everything just. Because as you go further back in the Big Bang, the hotter it gets.
Well, do you think our universe, because you know how we're always moving, we're in this spiral galaxy? So, like, do you think, like, there's something bigger out there, a bigger universe that could possibly be dropping us into, like, what's there? And we just be caught, and that's why.
I'll try to hold off on this until you get to your philosophy of science. But yeah, these are great questions that you should think about. You know, you have multiverse theories and stuff like that, there's multiple universes. Now, in the Greek notion of cosmos or universe, they just meant everything that exists. So they would probably laugh at the idea of multiverse. They would just say, well, that is the universe. All the multiverses, if that's what exists, are simply what we would call the universe. Anyways, I'll hold off on that, but that's a great question. We'll definitely get to that. The classical conception of causality. We talked about it's very different from our modern notion of. And in part, it's because when you get to modernity, every time period in the history of philosophy is a critique and responding back to their predecessors. Various issues and problems. What modernity did was a full rejection of Aristotelian cosmology, in philosophy. And as people tend to do, if there is some error, they don't tend to find the middle ground and bend the stick back, but go the other way. And so there was a sort of throwing the baby out with the bathwater. Everything just went. So the whole rejection in a new paradigm was introduced into. And part of that also included a throwing out of Aristotle's notion of causality. We understand, and this is why you had a difficulty answering the question, well, according to Plato, if the forms are eternal, then why do you need a cause for them? And you could say the same with Aristotle. If the material universe is eternal, why does the material universe require God or a cause for it to exist? Well, that doesn't make sense to you because you're thinking of a very narrow sense of causality. It's temporal, that a cause must always precede the effect in time. So what comes first, the cause, and then the effect. And also, that type of temporal causation is mechanistic, push and pulls. For the ancients, that was only one type of causal explanation. Really, the notion of cause means explanation. And that's why we said, well, suppose, for the sake of the argument, these two markers were eternally in my hands, supported 3 feet above the ground. And if I asked you, why are they being supported 3 feet above the ground, you answered, because. And so the being, the cause of the being is me. Does that have to proceed? Do I have to perceive those in time? No, they could be simultaneous because we assume that. It doesn't matter. There is an explanation of dependence. I'm not depending on these. These are depending on myself holding them up, and therefore I am the explanation or reason why these pens are 3 feet. And it has nothing to do with me being before in time or pushing or pulling, but simultaneous. So here is some classical understandings of the notion of cause. Whatever has an effect as its consequence is called a cause. Yes? That is a cause. Why? Because the effect as its consequence of this happening, this event. So consequence doesn't have to be temporal. It could be logical in the sense of explanation or reason. Remember, logos means reason in Greek. Now, cause is a Latin word, or at least it derives from the Latin word causa, casus, which belongs to the verb cadere. And cadere in Latin means to fall. So this action falls from this action. This reality of being supported 3 feet above the ground falls and is the consequence of this being here. And it means that which brings it, being 3 feet above the ground, existing 3 feet around, brings it about, that something turns out as a result in such a way, such and such a way as being 3 feet above the ground. The Greek word for cause is aption, which means that in which something else is indebted. So whatever effect that you see, its explanation, its existence, it owes it to something else. It owes it to the cause. Or you could say, the cause is that which is being responsible for bringing something into appearance. And again, bringing doesn't have to be temporal. We just think that way. And in part, it's because also it can be to occasion something. So the cause is to occasion an event or an effect. Aristotle believed out of all the explanations that you could give in which effects or phenomenon or existence are indebted to something else beyond itself, there were four fundamental explanations that you could categorize those into. A formal explanation, a material explanation, an efficient explanation, and a final explanation. In other words, Aristotle believed there are four causes in which you can use as a tool to interrogate the world and apprehend it in a much deeper sense than if you just limited yourself to only one type of explanation. I'm only going to give material explanations. Well, then you're going to be deficient in what you can explain. Because material cause or material explanation gives an answer to the question, what is this made out of? Or the material out of which something is made. If, like the moderns, in rejecting all of Aristotle's causes, suppose you said, I only believe in material explanations. How are you going to, I'm made out of matter, how are you going to explain the difference between this and this if you only have one type of explanation in your inventory that you can use? You can't. You're going to, oh yeah, but what is this matter made into? And what is this matter? Because we're all composed of atoms, that's true. That's a material explanation. Or material cause. So I'm indebted in part to what I'm composed out of materially. But that is not going to be enough to say what's the difference between this material object and this material object. You're going to have to say, well, what is the matter formed into? That's formed into a table. This is formed into a human being, a rational animal. So that's why we at least need two types of explanations. What something's made out of, and what the matter's made into. Or the form in which the thing is arranged. But then, who arranged it? Or what arranged? What was it indebted to? Well, that would be the efficient cause. And the efficient cause, according to Aristotle, answers the question of the mover, the source of the motion. Now, if it's an intelligent being, like a human being, then we call him an agent. And so sometimes you can refer to the source of your motion as the agent cause, which is your parents. Your parents are the agents that brought the motion or changing of you from non-existence into existence. So they're an efficient cause that we would call an agent cause. This is not an agent, but it is an efficient cause. So what's the source of this motion, this effect? The moving red pen. So that's an efficient cause. An artist would be an agent cause or an efficient cause when they're the explanation of the source of some motion and or some phenomenon. But also, we have one last one, which we leave as the final. Get it? That helps you. The last cause is the final cause. No? Okay. The final cause, Aristotle says, is the same as the formal cause. You're just looking at the form and its end temporal process. So you're looking at the form from the end rather than in the intermediate states. And that's going to answer the question of why, or for the purpose, for what purpose? So, the four causes of Aristotle illustrated in a sculptor. If you had the sculpture of Hermes here, is the material cause? What is it made out of?
The rock,
yeah, the marble, whatever the... What is the rock made into? The form of Hermes. Who was the source of that change in motion?
Hermes?
No, Hermes is, I don't think Hermes can move. I think he's had a stroke.
I can't see the name. What is whoever you're sculpting?
Yes, the artist. The artist. Let's give him a nice Greek name. Spiridon. 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 Spinicopola. Mr. Spinicopola here has the form or idea in his mind. The matter is potency. Potential what? Potential, the idea of Hermes, but not anything actual. And tell Mr. Spinacopola starts putting his idea and shaping the matter until it approximates what's in his mind. So he is the efficient cause. The marble or stone is the material. Hermes is the form. And there's going through different processes. The final cause is Hermes sculpted out at its very end. That is what he's working towards. And therefore, if you asked, well, what's the purpose of that sculpture? Hermes, the very end product. And that's what explains, well, why are you doing that? Why are you hitting? Is it just random? No, he's doing it for each successive step. For example, I could do a bunch of random things. Pull up my keys, throw them around, turn on the alarm, unlock the car, and you say, what are you doing? Nothing, I'm just acting crazy, doing a bunch of random things. Now, what if I take those random things and I order them? Why do you pull out your keys? So I can unlock my car. Why are you going to unlock the car? So that I can open my car. Why would you open your car, Dora? So I can get inside. Why would you want to get inside? So I can put my key in. Why? So for the next step, to turn it on. Why? So I can drive my car. Why? So I can get home. Now that end state now explains every other successive state and gives purpose to. Now it's not random anymore. And so you can think of both the artist and nature, which is a sort of artist in herself, acting that way. So one way to understand the final cause, Aristotle says, it answers the question, that for the sake of which. Why are you hitting that? For the sake of the next step. For the next step. For the sake of the next step, ultimately for the end. So it's the end vision, the form at the very end, that shows us and explains the purpose of every other event and material part. And you can see this even more profoundly in living nature. Using your concepts, potency, actuality, potency goes is synonymous with matter, and actuality is synonymous with form. And they exist together. You can't see forms. You can't taste them. You cannot, they're nothing tangible. Form is what you understand, and Aristotle would agree with Plato on that. What you see and sense is matter. So, let me give you a little, I'll have to wait till, because we're ending now. But we can say, is that an actual oak tree? No. Is it just carbon, hydrogen, and oxygen? Just about, no. So we need to employ four different types of explanation. What is it made out of? Organic material. What is it being made into? Oak tree. That's the form. So you can explain, what is that? It's a potential oak tree. You can only say something's potential if you have the idea of what actuality is. And because form is present in the matter in every place, form is there. You just can't see it. You might have to wait till it grows into an oak tree to see it. But then you can answer again, it's in terms of the final cause that I understand where this is going. notice this is not growing into that. It's not growing into a car or a house. So there must be some type of formal principle inside that's guiding and developing the material parts. Unlike an artist puts the form from the mind in, so outside into the matter. Nature, Aristotle says, is likened to an artist, but does her art from inside out. So there, as you see, nobody is pulling and shaping out the tree. The tree's doing it itself. So there's some type of internal principle, formal principle, that's binding all those material parts and guiding it to its proper end. That's why acorns don't grow into chickens. They grow into oak trees. And this is why Aristotle, will end with this, has a famous saying, nature, living things, always or acts for an end. Always or for the most part, because, yes, if I spill radioactive material on that or put it in a stony soil, guess what? It's not going to get to its end. There's things that can happen that impede its development and growth. But for the most part, nature always acts for an end. What does that mean? Acorns don't grow into the end product of a chicken or a human being. Acorns are potential oak trees, and they always grow into the end product of